Santa Barbara, and I actually just stopped by one day and called them up to see if I could come by and see them. So I actually saw this painting, and the kitchen table was actually above it. Like,
oh.
And so it was like in this kind of very meaningful space with his friend. So his friend had all these Beckmans in his house. It was bizarre. It was like 90 when I saw the collection. And then it sold for something like $64 million or something. So it's entered a different kind of economy. And that is the economy that Mike Cloud is talking about. So this has such a meaningful, important history, but that history is like also now attached to the idea that this thing is actually a very high commodity object that has got a pretty sweet price tag attached to it. And you can't ignore those two things existing at the same time. I mean, it really colors what this is in the same way that you were talking about history, like out of the context of its time, it's really hard to interpret some of these works. But then when it also becomes this high commodity object, it's also that thing. And the thingness of this work is very important. So that's something that, oops, I keep like pushing my computer. So that's something that is something Mike is using with utility here. So expressionism in his work, this is Julian's novel. Now this is a rather empty piece. This is neo-expressionism, and I'd equate this more like Annie Leibovitz. It's kind of easy, but it also talks about the value systems that we're looking at. So someone like Julian Schnabel just saw that, like, okay, here's the recipe, I'll do it. And you know, it functions. So the other thing that he's doing, and I think that he really loves to engage with ideas around authenticity, is these works are so deeply indebted to the what are they called? The
G's Ben
works. They're all over them. And that's just another level of authenticity that he's engaging. And these things took the same track that Beckman did. So they were made by these people who worked in the community. They put them together, they were meaningful for them, they're expressions of beauty for them, and now they're absolutely high commodity things. And so what he's done is he's taken like commodity, 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 and stuck them together, and he's made a new commodity, which is actually really commenting on commodity culture in general. And that's where he and I overlap, actually, because I'm very interested in those kinds of economies. Then we have this one, which I've already talked about a little bit. And with these, by now you can kind of see where I'm going with this. He is always interested in the sign. So like these things are always, they're signifying, whether they're signifying as a thing, as the thing that it is, as the thing that it's pretending to be or commenting on or engaging. So he, sign systems are wrapped within these works. And with these in particular, they come from a larger series, if I'm correct, because I think there was a yellow one and a purple one. And the purple is the gay signifier, and the yellow is Jewish. So that's legible, like that this has something to do with those histories, which is really interesting. So that's another place that we overlap greatly. And he is engaging with those value systems too. So I don't know if you talked about Malevich, but that's within this work. So what happens with this is it talks at first about the recognition, and I've already talked about this in this talk, about the painting as a thing. And Malevich was one of the first steps towards that, where one actually looked at this completely formal painting that was just simply about the formality of painting a thing. And then kind of naming it supremist, which is really interesting. And then from there, this then really shifted the way that we look at signs. And we started to understand a painting as something that is more than something that is a view of history. Do you guys know what this is? You don't? Have you ever heard of the army? What? No, it's Warhol.
It's Warhol.
Right.
Warhol's
so, and so now you've made my point. Right, yeah. So we understand a sign, and actually the fact that you guys didn't say it was camouflage, it at first, it makes me see you recognize that it wasn't actually camouflaged at all. I mean, it's just sitting there operating as a sign, right? And these are things that you can see within the work. So then we see these things that they have different kinds of utility, but then they end up operating as things that are signs in themselves. So there was a point that the Rothko was really wrapped up in abstract expressionism, which is this kind of individual, the kind of power of the individual, which ended up being like a way to promote democracy, and it sells for $50 million. Mm-hmm. And then the same thing with, so that now this moved away from being a sign of like being used by the government to promote democracy into something that is just consistently high commodity. Like it just equals money now, right? I mean, it's really the truth. And the same thing with Ellsworth Kelly. Like Ellsworth Kelly was like, he was shifting the idea about what a thing is. So his things are all observed. They're all things. He makes observational paintings, but they're put in the uniform of a modernist painting, which is supposed to be nothing at all, something. But the something now is a high commodity like object. So you see where I'm going here. And this is, I love this one. Do you guys know Ed Ruscha? So this one kind of gets to the point, the same kind of point. And he actually targets the New York Times. So the New York Times isn't just the news, but it's like the news. It's like the place that holds history. And I thought this, like, I love this painting for that reason. And I don't need to say more, right? So I can just keep pushing this and pushing it. So this is all embedded within this work, where he's really looking at signs. Yeah, and that's where I'm gonna leave it, because this is supposed to be a short talk. Yeah, sorry that it wasn't so short.
Thank you. Start us off with a question?
And I don't have to if someone else has a question.
Could you talk about the commodification, the commercialization of the painting, you know, when a painter does it in the context, they're not, some are assuming they're going to be worth millions of dollars, and that's the point they make. But
Jeff Koons' work is all about commodity.
Commodity.
Yeah, and his work, probably among all work being made presently, is one of the best reflections of the actual culture we're living in. So I would say the reason he's important and probably very hated is because his work's very accurate. Like, I mean, there's something about the, what is it, the king's new clothing, or the emperor's new clothing. Yeah, so he makes these ridiculous things and gets people to pay ridiculous prices for them. And
it's
a social commentary, I'd say, his work's very, I mean, talk about efficacy. Like,
you have a wonderful painting that's unrecognized, but then all of a sudden it gets recognized. You say, we're looking at the thing, does it become a different thing? Say, my clouds, rape of the Sabine women, it's here. You said he couldn't, you said he should have been part of the canon in the National Gallery, but he can be.
I have shown he will be.
Will that change?
It's the point of the piece.
Will that change the work?
It's the
I
point
know
of
that's the,
piece. The
point of it, but well, if the artist has done it, for whatever reason, the artist has created something, but then
it becomes discovered,
does that change?
Okay, so these
what
are two
means.
Different conversations that you proposed, and one of them is Mike Cloud. So that's Mike Cloud
right,
is not
separate.
This artist
right.
that you're talking about.
General.
So Mike Cloud's work is actually made around ideas of the canon.
Okay.
So if for this piece to actually work, it has to get into the National Gallery, or it fails. Like it belongs there because that's actually the intention of the work.
You commented, I can't use the exact word you used, that it should be there.
I didn't say it won't be there.
You used a different word.
No. I didn't say that. I think it, we were just talking about that actually the painting is about being there.
Yeah.
So I think for the painting to actually see its full.
Well, then the word, all right.
Yeah.
No, I got the sense that it should be there.
But then, like, what you're suggesting is that, and this is the thing that he's really engaging with, something underneath you wants to say something about sincerity. And I think, like, that's what I'm reading. So, and,
Does it change the thing? The painting is a thing. Once it becomes commodified, does that change the thing that it is?
I think that there are always multiple things going on at the same time. So when I'm talking about this Sebastian painting, I'm recognizing that there's about four things that are all going on at the same time. So I don't think they lose their previous utility, it may not be able to be read, and it may not read the same way in our culture. Sometimes things gain value because of history. I think Vermeer's paintings are probably valued now more than when they were made because he appeals to modern aesthetic. Like there's something pared down and simple about his work that appeals to us. So it might be that that work was not as successful then as it is now because it appeals to our tastes. So the all these things live very independently.
I understand that, but
I'm thinking this, in this conversation, I'm thinking of like Dutch still lives and tulips. And so artists started painting tulips because you could no longer import them and have the actual flowers.
They're
so
conceptual works.
Right. That utility was very clearly about can't have the real thing, so let's represent it. We will call this a valuable commodity, as would be the thing that you can't have. But now
it was about trade too.
It was about trade. And now those paintings are not valuable because we can't get tulips. They're valuable because they're Dutch masters still.
Yeah. And the way that they're painted and the beauty of the way they're painted. Yeah. And the kind of they're coded. You know, and so they're valued by some people because they're just a nice painting, but other people value the kind of coded quality of them.
Right.
You know, there's more than what one actually can see. It's going. So one can go into those paintings and just simply like them, which is fine with most artists, but there's also much more going on.
Yes.
Yeah. But then, you know, sometimes with paintings, there is not much more going on. Like, not every person has to have an agenda.
And that's what I'm thinking. You have a painting and it doesn't have an agenda to be commodified. But does it take on a greater import if you're going to buy it for $10 million versus it's hanging in somebody's kitchen? It's the same work?
Depends on the person. I mean, you can't replace sentimentality. You know, like if you have an attachment to something, there's nothing more valuable to you. So it doesn't really matter. I'm talking about kind of larger cultural.
Yeah, well, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
In the larger context.
Well, so the larger context, this thing in your kitchen's not going to really be seen. So, you know, and what I'm also suggesting is that artists are fully aware of what they're engaging in. So this is not a work that's actually intended to be in a kitchen. You know, so it wouldn't actually live comfortably there. Wouldn't really make sense there. Wouldn't really make the person very happy. I don't know who wants to look at a collaged any leafboards in their kitchen. So, you know, like, so that there's different kind of utility, and so, but intention's hugely important. And if your intention is not as layered as this artist, you know, like, if you want to paint a cat, and you're happy to paint the cat, and the cat can look nice in someone's kitchen, then it's fine. Yeah? Unless it's a Malthus's painting, that becomes something else. So that's another question.
I was wondering about intention, and he obviously has that in mind with putting Albers and Leibovitz and so forth and so on together. What do you feel about people who paint without all of these things embedded in their work? Can a painting that is just a beautiful painting that an artist produces have the same kind of importance as somebody who has all this other stuff going, significant things happening within it?
I think everyone's energy is important. So I think I can't answer that question for someone else. I can talk about where my energy goes, and I can recognize the value of someone else's energy. So like, I don't think people should make things for other people's reasons. That goes back to your point. I mean, I think there's many different worlds and many different art worlds. And but what we're talking about with this artist is an engagement in history and the canon and value systems and their cultural value systems. So like, that has nothing to do with Mike Cloud's intentions. That's just someone else's intentions. So like, I think that there are very different kinds of, I mean, I'm invited here to talk about this work because he bumps into my interests. So it makes sense for me to talk about this work. Like if someone else talked about this work, you'd have a different, someone else might come in and just say, like have a conversation about form or color. I don't know, it would be interesting to have a series of people. But the, I have a different relationship to this work. So my relationship is specific to this. I'm not making an argument about anybody else's work or someone else's intention, because I think it's not, there's not a single world.
It sure isn't.
Yeah. Seriously, I mean, that's, I know that's simple, but I mean, that's something that propelled Mike Cloud to actually make the work that he makes. I mean, if we kind of accept our position, then that's he wouldn't make the work that he makes. Like, he's gone out, I mean, this work is so much about class, you know, when he engages, like, especially this kind of celebrity culture, you know, like, I mean, many artists are not involved in the conversation, could not be involved in the conversations that they are engaging. Like, Andy Lucas doesn't care what he thinks. So, like, I think what, this is personal, but I think, to me, the value of an artist and the artist's role in a culture is to reflect it. Mm-hmm. And the other part, which may be interesting for you to think about, is we make things that people want to engage. So, like, the thing that I want to reflect or engage isn't necessarily what someone else wants to reflect or engage. There's different kind of life experiences, and I mean, you know, sometimes someone really wants to simply talk about something they think is beautiful, and that's what you're suggesting.
Yeah.
So, like, that's a very different kind of intention. It's a different kind of world that you're trying to engage. This is an academic person who's chosen to work as an academic. His work is engaged. It's very strongly conceptual work. He's not very interested in issues of beauty, I would imagine. So, I don't know.
Yeah, I think that's probably right. But I think that, well, he comes out of, as Tim said, he's still a pretty young artist. In fact, these collages, a lot of the work and the things that he's working through are issues that he was working through in graduate school. So he's still, like, it's still very fresh ideas.
Where did you go to graduate school?
You.
Let's see, these are smart paintings.
Yeah. but he started out, he was working in abstract painting, and he was kind of fed up with it and felt like he couldn't, he wasn't contributing, you know? So I'm another abstract painter, but also identity was something that I think, he's never explicitly said that he was asked to address his identity, but he is a large, straight black man, and so people wanted him to be making artwork about being a black man, not abstract painting. So he started thinking, and you kind of touched on this in like Annie Leibovitz and Mike making, he could never make her work, but it's just like a totally different space. And yeah. So he was thinking about who is the artist that is the most opposite of me? How can I get to a place where I can just completely let go of my identity? Well, it's a gay Jewish female photographer.
Celebrity.
Yeah. And so I think, you know, it's really, and looking at what celebrity and beauty, we started talking about this in terms of beauty, and I think literally in his quilts, he pokes holes in Leibovitz's work.
There you go. Yeah. So I started making abstract work after making figurative work for a very long time, because in order for me to talk about the things that I needed to talk about, actually couldn't have a person, because I was talking about ideas. And the only way I could actually get there was through something that was more opaque. So like, I developed a body of work kind of the same reason. So that because what abstraction does actually is it embeds information. And it can be pretty opaque, which is fine with me. I mean, you can simply like something. I think it's totally fine with him too. But there's actually, it's a great receptacle of content, because you have to wait and you have to look. So it's not something like, I think a figurative work, a piece of figurative work has an entirely different kind of issue, because a lot of what we're talking about is the way a genre actually operates and the expectations of that genre. And so when you think about the expectations of expressionism, it's about feeling, you know? And I, like, in my particular case, because I'm thinking about how he engages the genre, for much of my career, have dealt with the genre of portraiture, and that also has something to do with film. Because someone wants to, there's an expectation that there'll be something delivered with a portrait, and that's a kind of truth. And I'm actually not interested in that. So I use the genre actually as a foil, and that's the same thing that both of us are doing with abstraction. So we make abstract paintings. I'm perfectly happy if you see one of these and you like them, but they're actually about something. And they're coded, and I have a couple I can show you.
Yeah, do show us.
Do you want to see?
Yeah.
This is another level. I forgot about this one. So this is really bumps into what I'm doing by explicitly using clothing. So when we talk about a sign, what we're all doing right now is we're actually walking advertisements for point of view. So like these, we can all be read. I'm reading you right now. You're very easy to read.
This is another Mike Cloud piece, by the way.
Yeah, so this is a Mike Cloud with children's clothing. But like the polo that you're wearing, like that's an identifiable, that's a sign. You know, it comes fully loaded. And it announces something. But we all do. Like that's what we do when we walk into a room. So that's what drew me to making a figure of works. Like I rely on how one reads clothing, but then I actually play with that too. So generally when I work with models, I'm either asking them to make a decision, often around clothing, or I look at a decision that's already been made. So these are kind of the two ways that I work. And this is a series of non sequiturs. So it's something that is realistic, and it has nothing to do with the person that, and I actually don't understand this painting, and probably the person that sat for it doesn't either, because it actually doesn't mean anything. So it's a bunch of things that are like misfiring and don't make any sense. So this is, do you guys know this book, The Context of No Context? There's no context. This is completely meaningless. And it's been traveling around on a show with the National Gallery, and people think it's about patriotism. It's really about the kind of insanity of fashion and the kind of the lack of need for context. You know, because within fashion, context is out the door. People just like something because of its shape, maybe, like who knows. And then these are two different kinds of commodities that are embedded into one another. And one of them is actually a high commodity sock, and the other is a Kuba textile. And the textile is something that's highly commodified. And so that's why these strongly relate, while they look nothing like his work, the ideas are very similar.
How big is that?
Well, kind of like the size that it is. Yeah. So this is actually an explanation about why I'm here, these works, because what they are is just embedded. But that's actually back to Mike Cloud. So I thought that might come up. Yeah. More questions?
Can I am reluctant to dumb this down. Awesome.
Sometimes I like talk so much that I don't allow questions.
Well, I'll ask a very naive question. I think I heard you say that the meaning of Mike Cloud's great buffoonery of the Saving Woman is easily understood.
Oh, I didn't say that. I said it's opaque.
It's opaque.
Yeah, like yeah, he works in opacity.
Yeah, so it's opaque to me.
Yeah, so what he's doing is like he's basically essentially using the title as the sign, and by engaging that painting that's within the canon, he puts himself into the company of Picasso, Jericho, David, blah blah blah, Rubens, you know, so like, and Mike Cloud. And eventually he actually made it comfortably fit in that company. It's a very interesting choice because one puts themselves into positions. So he's actually positioning himself in his aspirations. He doesn't even need to paint The Rape of the Sabine Woman. It's not important. Like, and this is a much more interesting contemporary version of that. And he's actually bringing it into his own experience too by writing into the work. So it's not, there's actually more going on in this painting than there. Like, so I'm saying that actually it's quite opaque, and yeah, so. it's kind of serves the utility that it needs to. I mean, look at the relationship. That's actually why I showed Caroline Kennedy and the Picasso's version, because Picasso's actually almost like a key to this piece. It's just the next step. Like, but he's at least being more honest, if we're talking about honesty.
I think what I struggle with, and this may get, I'm not interested in trying to turn this into a personal thing, but as a lawyer, I'm probably going to be more inclined toward something more clearly representational. It's easier for my mind to get around. And
this is a conceptual work.
He's made a choice to associate himself now with this canon. And these prior artists who are part of this, entrenched in the canon. So there have to me, as a more linear thinking person, then there has to be meaning other than that choice. He's trying to make some kind of point or commentary on that canon intuitively.
Yeah,
but I don't understand it.
He's overtly placing himself within a trajectory. You understand that? So like he...
Yes, but toward what, other than that end, what is the meaning of the painting?
That is the meaning of the painting. So like, what he's using something that operates in opacity, right? Like if you put my painting back up, you can like that painting. It is really hard to understand what that painting means unless I tell you, right? So, and that's the same thing he's doing. So he's actually working in abstraction. Letters are abstract. So he's actually, this is not a figurative painting. He's engaging in an idea around value, and he's using abstraction to engage that conversation. So like, it's a very non-romantic idea, entrenched in romance, because he's using expressive mode. So like, the levels of what's going on here, and he's a young guy, so there's a kind of intuitive interest too, where he's using a little bit of his gut, and it's a reaction. He's also looking at his own identity, and that's where the idea of, like, he could make this really simple and simply put, like, black figures in the painting, and then he'd be Robert Colescott, you know, but that's not something that he wants to do. He's making it harder. He's making it hard. I'm not trying to satisfy anyone, but in that way, I don't think that's really particularly an artist's job. You know, unless they want to engage in another kind of endeavor, you know, like, and maybe that's the kind of work that is more comfortable, you know, in a different kind of situation than this. You know what I mean?
I kind of appreciate making it hard. I guess some of us would at some point like the answer, and it's, you know, it may remain for some of us who are just too simple. It will always be elusive.
But I would say
undiscovered.
No, but I think you should flip your expectation. Like, I think what he's giving you is something better than an answer. He's giving you something provocative. So like, you can disagree with me. You are welcome to. But you should. You know, like, that's, I mean, I'm a teacher too. So I'm just, like I said, this is just a response. This is not an art history lesson.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have a degree in art history. You know, like, I actually, you know, I have an interest, and clearly I make relationships with things. I think that's part of my job. But I think he's giving you something better than an answer. He's actually provoking you. Like, he's actually giving you a question. That's the value of what he's doing. You know, like, some of these paintings are really hard. You know, but they also talk about something that's hard to talk about. That's just how constructed the information that we get through paintings is. So sometimes when something's ostensibly giving you an answer, it actually might not be. Like, it may be that I can talk about my work in this capacity a little bit more easily, but someone's going to buy that painting and have no idea what it's about. And it's kind of a critical painting. It's a little bit cynical even. I just happen to enjoy making it, which is better than, you know, I like to make them. And I'm fine if people don't understand them, but the truth of it is, it's a critique. And the wrapping that I'm using is just different from the wrapping he's using. I also paint them with these kind of shiny areas so that you kind of want them. So I'm really interested in that. But the truth of it is that it's a lie. Like, there's something, there's many things going on. And I often engage things that are engaging art. So like, within the striped piece that you saw, it could be having a conversation with Gene Davis. But it's actually somebody ripping off Gene Davis and putting on a shirt, and then me taking it back and putting it into art. And in the case of the Kruba textile that I use, that's something that's highly collectible. And I'm very attracted to it. I saw a show of Kruba textiles. And one of the first time I ever saw one of those paintings, I was doing a talk on Randy Green that day about this. And her self-portrait, she has a Kruba textile in it. So it's been this highly commodified thing forever. And what it's lost is actually its meaning, because it's collectible and it's a thing. But what I found is, what did I do with that chain? So this is actually a male status fabric, a pattern. So within that culture, that's identifiable. And what I've done is actually returned it to its meaning, because the stripes are also a male commodity object, a status object. So these are both actually of equal meaning. That doesn't, you may not know that from looking at the painting, but it's embedded. And that's kind of what he's doing. So I'd say he's offering you something better than an answer. He's offering you kind of a question or something that you can actually enter into.
If there's something to me, and again, I hate to make it personal, but you explaining what you did with that coating makes that painting so much more impactful and makes that piece so much more impactful and more interesting.
But don't you think that's more interesting when you have to start thinking about it in the trajectory?
I think I'm fascinated by the painting. I've been fascinated since it's been up, but I can't crack the code.
You did crack the code. Like, by simply reading it, you're cracking the code. Like, he's just being more overt.
He's pointing.
Yeah, he's just pointing at something of value and then positioning himself within it.
He's just obviously making arrows and pointing at things.
Yeah. You actually understand it.
Well, what he's doing, of course, is
your concern actually understands. You should buy it and then give it to the National.
I'm curious, I mean, the way that he's inserted himself into that canon is a few words on the canvas. And there are other ones, like Raytheon.
Well, what about Picasso? Did it in an afternoon, like 15 minutes.
I'm sorry, what?
I don't know what time has to get to do with this. Like, look at the Picasso piece. He did it like in, you know, 3 hours.
Well, what I'm saying is that it is the words rather than the images that put it in that canon. And there's also racial mythology and stories about money on there, more words. And the title of the piece is something different as well.
That's the interesting part, though. So that's where it gets to your issue.
Yeah.
So then what he's bringing along with this is something that's contemporary.
Okay.
Right.
Well, I have a question, which is
what?
To your knowledge, how often have words have been used to insert a work into a canon, or to have this effect?
I think that's a very interesting question because that is something more contemporary. You know, you've got Ed Ruscha, who painted in the '60s, who used words kind of consistently. He's the one that did the news.